director and chief curator of the Panama Canal Museum. Before I get started, I just wanted to get a bit of a survey. Can I get a show of hands of who of you work on an institution that is undergoing, has undergone recently, or planning to undergo a transformation of their exhibition spaces? Show of hands. Okay, and how many of you want the transformation in the institution you're working on but have no idea where to start? None? Wow, okay. Well, the Panama Canal Museum is, as Shani mentioned before, and thank you for the introduction, undergoing a massive transformation. We've already opened three renovated spaces, and we have two more to go, so we're supposed to finish in 2025, hopefully. I'm going to focus on the first phase of that renovation, which was about the topic Life in the Canal Zone, and I'm going to present a brief contextual history of Panama to explain why the need of diversifying the narratives inside our renovation. So bear with me while I summarize around 700 years of history. So the Panama Canal Museum, the Panama Canal Museum was inaugurated in 1997 as a nonprofit institution with the mission to rescue and preserve the cultural heritage of Panama and its canal. Now, to give you a context of the time, this was around 3 years before the administration of the canal was passed from the United States to Panama. And the national sentiment of the time was that there needed to be a place that rescued and recovered the struggle of Panama to regain sovereignty over its entire territory for the future generations. It wasn't until Panama was an independent country from 1903, and very shortly afterwards, we signed a treaty with the United States that granted them the rights to the land and resources to build the feat of engineering that changed the world, the Panama Canal. However, it wasn't until nearly a century later we'd be able to fully own and share that history. But why is our history relevant? So Panama has always been a bridge and a point of contact culturally, and point of exchange, and a transit route. Our geographical position has rendered us ideal for the transit of species as well as commercial goods. And we have evidence that even before the colonization of Spain, there were a lot of interactions and cultural contact between the indigenous groups of the region. Under the Spanish crown and after the Spaniards discovered that our land united two oceans, our position as a route and a point of connection solidified. Commercial fairs were established and trade routes as well, in which not only commercial goods but also humans were sold and trafficked. When gold was discovered in California, and that's a nice segue to our previous presentation, in 1849, Panama became key to shorten the route from east to west, and that's when the Trans-Isthmian Railway was built under U.S. jurisdiction, importing labor from England, Ireland, Italy, Germany, Austria, France, El Salvador, India, China, and a lot from the Caribbean, especially Jamaica. And the import of labor was true for the construction of the canal as well. Around the 19th century, European nations and the United States were looking at building a canal through the Americas to shorten the route from one ocean to the other. And the French proposal won the rights to build a canal, and Panama was identified as the shortest route. However, due to mismanagement of funds, disease, loss of life, and inclement weather conditions, the French eventually went bankrupt. And that's when the US retook the interest in constructing a canal through Panama. That's around the time in 1903 where we signed a treaty with them, granting the rights to the land that would allow them to complete the construction of the canal in 1914. During, from 1903 to 1914, the U.S. hired nearly 50,000 people from 97 nationalities that traveled to Panama and made our small territory their home. Most of the labor was from the Caribbean, especially from Barbados. And the canal zone was the land that we had granted them through that treaty. It was a stretch of land that was United States territory where Panamanians were not allowed without authorization. In this land, in this territory, segregation laws were implemented. And instead of going by white and colored, the canal zone was ruled by a segregated payroll called the gold and silver payroll. So if you were a white American, you were paid in American gold. And if you were from everywhere else, you'd get paid in Panamanian silver. And the difference in salary, housing, education, food, and human rights was dramatically disproportionate, especially to those sailing from the Caribbean. You can see a picture here from the construction, the engineers and the foremen from the gold roller in the front and the silver roller in the back. These were the conditions under which the Panama Canal was built. Now, that's 700 years, summary, done, check. Now to the renovation. So I was recruited as executive director of the Panama Canal Museum in 2020, and I moved from London, where I was directing an arts foundation, back to Panama in August 2020. Yes, in the middle of the COVID-19 pandemic. And I was tasked with evaluating and restructuring the entire museum, from the organizational and administrative, to the branding, to the programming, to the permanent exhibition spaces. Yes, in the middle of the COVID-19 pandemic. And I want to focus on the first phase of the exhibition renovation that I mentioned before, and this covered the topics of life in the canal zone that I briefly glossed over, and share with you some of the many challenges that we face and the lessons we learned along the way. So this is how the exhibition looked in 2020. Yeah. So the reason why we decided to start with this particular exhibition space was not just because it was the oldest one, but also because, I don't know if you can tell from the mannequins, but it doesn't look very diverse, at least not 97 nationalities diverse. And it looks very white. And the design was very outdated. You can see the glare on the walls. There's bad lighting, there's text over images, over more text. It just doesn't seem inviting. It was also not very inclusive. There were no texts at the level of a wheelchair, for instance. And at that time, the majority of our audience were international tourists, and all of this text is in Spanish. There was no way for them to actually read it. Moreover, it just baffles me every time I see this. I can't believe it's been a couple of years. But it focused the content on the engineers and the great engineering feat and what they did. But it always felt that they were neglecting to talk about the difficult parts of that history, the segregation especially. And it sort of it felt like it had been sterilized. Like they were invisibilizing the difficult parts of speaking of the canal zone and the segregation laws, and invisibilizing the workers as well from so many countries that made Panama their home. And I just couldn't help but wonder, where were we? Where was this multicultural territory that has impacted so many aspects of our culture, our gastronomy, our art, our history? Where were we in this space? Why was it more important to talk about the grocery list of a Gold Roll employee than the fact that we have segregated housing? Why were we not speaking about how the laws implemented in this territory meant that the police could arrest someone for being lazy and marauding and force them to labor in order to grant them their freedom? It just didn't seem, I couldn't understand it. And additionally to the content, which was problematic enough, the space itself is not inviting to the user. This is, bear in mind, this is the second floor of the museum, so you've already gone through a lot of it. And what does it inspire you to do? Read? This is what it inspired me to do. It was very cathartic. To break down outdated narratives, to diversify its content, and to completely transform the exhibition space, showcasing the feat of engineering, yes, but also the true life in the canal zone. So the first challenge we were met with was the initial reaction. Now, as I mentioned before, I had just moved from London back to Panama. I was quarantined for the first couple of weeks of my role, and I got to meet the team through Zoom. And we had a lot of conversations. I explained to them the plans to restructure the museum, to renovate the exhibition space. And it was met with some resistance. Many of the museum staff had been there for many years, and they couldn't see anything wrong with the exhibition. In fact, some of them even felt attacked that I was pointing out areas of improvement. And we did have a lot of talks explaining the gaps, and many of them did see it, but there were some that were afraid to rock the boat. And the initial reaction was not just to the exhibition changes, but also to my leadership. The fact that a young woman was coming over to lead the largest museum of the country was a decision that was supported by the Board of Trustees, but not by everybody else. I faced a lot of backlash, not just from the public, but also from my staff, that asked that I prove my worth and my professionalism and my experience to be able to lead this museum. It was tricky, I'm not gonna lie. At the time, 3 weeks into this gargantuan task, my head of exhibitions quit. So the first lesson I think I can share with you is to trust your gut. It can be very daunting when you're taking on such a big project and such a big responsibility to feel that your own staff doesn't know if it's the right thing, if you're the right thing. But a decision like this to completely transform a permanent exhibition space doesn't come lightly. It takes research, it takes data, it takes courage. And at that point, you just need to trust your gut and create a team that will help you make that a reality, because you will always find people that do not agree with what you're doing, but you just have to plow ahead and take the ones that do. So the second challenge that we faced was the signing over Zoom. Have any of you done that? It's insane. So it's madness. We had our research department trying to explain to us over Zoom the content that would go on the exhibition space, while the exhibitions team was trying to make sure that it fit in the exhibition space through an old floor map and old photos, because we were all quarantined at the time. And the collections team was having an anxiety breakdown, and I was trying to keep calm and carry on. I was leading an exhibition transformation by getting familiar with the space, the collection, and the team through Zoom. So it was insane, yeah. But you know what? Creativity blooms in the weirdest of places. And we always assign with the user in mind. And actually, this gave us a way to exercise our creativity even more so. So over Zoom, we'd have to use props or close our eyes and transmit what we're trying to convey to the user just through words. So it was stressful, I'm not gonna lie, but it was also a lot of fun. And we tried to transmit what the color, the light, the sound, the way and the route through which the user would use the space should go. What would they feel? And it's putting yourself in the user's shoes and also think of how is this space transmitting the message I want to get across. It's something that it's not for the faint-hearted, but it's a great exercise to try out to let your mind and creative juices run wild. So that's also a lesson we learned on the way. And now the third challenge was the limited nearby bibliography. And this was a tricky one because we had, just to give you a context, in Panama, the topics that we were trying to cover in this exhibition are not taught in schools. If anything, they're glossed over, if mentioned at all. So we had some bibliography to start our research from, but our team really wanted to make a deep dive into historical archive, census, first-person narrative, maybe from in the form of letters or postcards. But obviously, due to COVID, we didn't have access to many of these. And also around that time, my head of research decided to quit. So, yeah, what's fun? So what did we do? We asked for help, and it was amazing. Actually, Samap is here, so shout out to Samap. But they were our saviors, honestly. We reached out, and they were fantastic in loaning us not only their books and their resources, but also their archival data, photographs, and even school yearbooks, which were incredible to inform us, inform our research. And not only that, but they also sat down with us and talked with us for hours, which I could have gone on for many more, by the way, and put us in touch with people whose histories, whose families had traveled to Panama for the construction of the canal, and gave us oral history material that we could use. As well, we reached out to George S. Mather's libraries in the University of Florida, who have digitalized their archive, which was great. And we also outsourced and hired a historian that was based in the United States and had access to the physical bibliography and data that we did not. So don't be afraid to ask for help. I think I have it on the next slide. We managed to include a fantastic oral history experience in the exhibition, in which our own Arcelio Hartley is part of. And they're reading letters from 1963 celebrating 50 years of the construction of the canal and the lives on, and the conditions under which they did that. So that's a preview of how it looks now. Our fourth challenge were the gaps in our collection. As I previously mentioned, we weren't covering these topics previously, and we realized very quickly that we didn't have artifact or material to illustrate the narratives we were wanting to make visible. So at the time, what we did was to engage the community. We launched a social media campaign in which we were asking institutions and people to loan us or donate archival material, photographs, artifacts even if they had any, in order to be able to illustrate that period of time and that particular topic. And I'm very glad to say that we got 730 artifacts on loan or donation, 466 of which are exhibited in the current Life in the Canal Zone exhibition. So, it was insane. And engaging your community comes as a double win, because not only are you getting, I can't stress enough the importance of engaging your community in the design process of your exhibition, because not only do you acquire material, data, archives, etc., and first-person narratives as well from their own experience, their perspective as users will grant you insight into things that by being in the space all the time, you might not be seeing, or needs that are not being met. So again, your community is, if you can take one of my recommendations, that's the first and foremost, but storytelling wise, it didn't fit at the beginning, so it's number four, which is my favorite number. I have to say that it also generated a, okay, 3 minutes, I'll run. It also generated a huge expectation for the upcoming exhibition, which was fantastic. And the fifth and last challenge, unfortunately, not all public opinion was very positive. A lot of stakeholders, donors, and members of the public complained to me or in social media saying awful things like, who told you this? You weren't there, you weren't, you know. Or this is not happening in history, or why should I know this? I'm not Black. Unfortunately, Panama, even though it's a very diverse country, it has been segregated, has been colonized and had segregation laws implemented that clearly have impacted our society till this day. So what do you do when your public and your audience isn't ready for the transformation that you want to lead? You explain your why. We have found the best approach to tackle these biases is to explain the reasoning behind the transformation or changes that you want to implement. So you're not just engaging your community at the end result, and you're not just giving them an exhibition, you're making them part of the process. And by creating that sense of ownership and that they're part of that process, they'll appreciate it and respect it so much more. As I mentioned before, this is obviously not a history that is taught in school, so to me, just walking around the exhibition spaces nowadays and hearing many, many people locally and internationally say, oh, I didn't know this happened here, has made it all worth it. And I'm very pleased to say that since we opened in March 2021, we've tripled the audience numbers since before the pandemic. So just a couple of pictures to show you how it looks now. The renders are on the top left and the pictures on the bottom right. We use some technology to show the changes in the canal zone geography. We also have a fantastic space with the artifacts that were donated and loaned, and some interactive experiences in which we have rendered the architecture for the housing of the gold roll and the silver roll. Some other artifacts and the oral history I shared with you earlier. So there are still many areas of research and gaps that we have to fill, but I'm thrilled of the work that we have begun. I'm finishing now. it's an ongoing process because change is obviously inevitable and it's a constant. And how we go about it is up to us as professionals in each of our institutions. as I mentioned earlier, we can see something so often and walk through the spaces so much that we might consider something certain. So if I can leave you with one thing, is to stay curious. Question what you consider it certain and look for and recognize those voices that are missing. And if you trust your gut, let creativity flow in the face of adversity. Ask for help when needed and outsource when needed. Engage your community and communicate your why. You have a recipe that can get you started. And let me know if you need any further help, because I'll be there. So while not everybody might join you for the full journey, the daring will come for the ride.
Questions,
Adelisa. Wow, congratulations. I must admit that I went, wow, so young. No, I had a feeling like that category of people saying but my question is, about the funding part, I mean, that's like kick ass. And where do you get all the money? Because I'm sure there were people, and this is my theory, as we open up and make all these things accessible, there will be people who come out of wanting to fund because there's all these reasons.
Yeah.
Which good, which you leave, but how do you get, and how much has this cost, and how would you get the money?
So that exhibition space was 180 square meters, and I'm just gonna say it unfiltered. The people that used to donate exhibition spaces before my arrival at the museum did not want to fund an exhibition space that was silver and gold roll. Fortunately for us, we had a contract with the Panama Canal in which they hired us to advise them on historical, archival, and collections material. So we used some of the money that we got from that contract in order to invest it into this renovation space. That's how we do.
I have a question. And going back to the definition of a museum, I'm wondering if your museum is a non-profit in the context of the definition.
As in, we don't make money out of it.
Absolutely.
Yeah, I mean.
Do you make money? Do you charge? Is it
free? We charge because it covers around 20% of our costs.
Well, what do you understand a non-profit?
Not to make money, to generate economic gain for.
I'm not disagreeing with you.
Yeah.
I just wanted to know what your definition is. Mine just happens to be a little different, that's all.
Oh, could you tell me?
I'll stop. Yeah.
Okay.
You
got to
share.
No, but, yeah.
Hey, so.
Why?
Because you've now piqued the curiosity.
I've been persuaded shot, my arm being twisted. So I will offer some more comments.
Yeah.
You see, I'm at the Abbey Theater, I was looking at the definition, and it says the definition encompasses a non-profit. But museums charge tickets, they raise money, and
do you know how much it costs to run
the museum? No, that's the point. I know it costs. I have a museum, and I know. Well, I know what I've spent. So I'm saying, I don't think nonprofit should be included in the definition. That's my point.
Okay. Well, I feel like that's a discussion for a different room.
Yeah.
Because
it's a different room.
Not right now, but I do think there's something to be said about how finances operate. And can you operate in service of your community and also make a profit as a larger institution? And I think those are discussions that have to happen in a larger scale. And I think there's space for it. But given that we only have 10 minutes, I do think...
No, I'm going to finish off.
Okay.
I did.
You have 30 seconds.
I can finish it in less than 30
okay,
seconds.
Okay, go ahead. You take it up, Pat. You're 30 seconds.
You okay. know, I would stop it.
Okay. All right, so we'll take from, it can happen different. I just think that we need to finish this discussion. Sama, and then I know your name. I'm sorry, I keep calling you Sama. And Natalie and Lisa. Yeah.
Yeah.
Arcelio.
Sorry. Yes.
I stand because I want to really congratulate.
Aww.
I want to say because I don't think that in this room we have gotten the depth of what she's done. She put over there in the glass, I was kind of wondering about it because she put up, you know, first for the railroad construction, she said they brought workers from all these places and from the Caribbean. And then for the canal, she said they brought from 97 nationalities from the Caribbean and most of them were Barbados. But we never got clear numbers. And we need to understand that the majority, the vast majority came from the Caribbean. And, you know, 50,000, but 40,000 of them would have been from the Caribbean and stuff like that. So it's significant that the canal really was launched on the backs of Caribbean. They were not slaves, they came as contracting workers, but they had this liberal role to push them. And the fact that over the years, they have really not had, even within Panama, it's come to, there was a time when the Caribbean, when the black West Indian workers were outlawed. They were actually, by a constitutional in 1941, they were declared persona non grata. They were not, there were immigrant prohibitions in the country. So to come all the way over and start to recognize them in this manner is great. It's not just a lighthearted thing. What she did in changing up this narrative, going against the grain, in order to highlight the Caribbean contribution, I think we need to understand that clearly.
And I want to follow up that said, the Caribbean knows the contribution of Caribbean nationals to the canal.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So to know that in Caribbean history, there are books that talk about the Bajan movement to Panama, and to realize that in Panama, they're not even acknowledged. And we know that there are Caribbean communities that have basically maintained Caribbean cultural practices in Panama, of course.
We have a small museum, the West Indian Museum of Panama, which is there for 40 years, 42 years.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, long before the Canal Museum came into being. And part of the internal debate we would have had, she had her own conscious debates there. When the time came, and she would kind of knock the door and say, I need help. Internally, we had to debate with our own folks who were saying, why isn't the government giving us that? Why are they doing this and doing this to our museum rather than doing it to their museum?
Mm.
So we had to come, and it was finally a challenge of understanding, we don't care where it goes as long as it's highlighting it.
Mm.
And so.
So Natalie,
yes, so we had, I don't want to name names, so, but there was a particular archive in the Caribbean that we reached out to, and they were charging us $16,000 to get the material digitalized and sent over on email. So we couldn't afford that, unfortunately. It was a shame. Others wanted to help, but at the time, COVID, they didn't have access to the archival material, so we couldn't actually access. But it's, as I mentioned, an ongoing process, and we want to not completely renovate that because it's just new, but we want to update it with more data as we go along and now I can access the data we wanted.
Lisa?
Yeah, just real quick, and I look forward to this day experiencing your work. What I wanted to know is, in the labor of making it, were you able to hire from Panama? And it would almost like to replay this idea of, like, we can do it ourselves.
You mean the staff that built the exhibition?
Yeah.
Oh yeah, it's all in-house museum staff. all of our, everything, even the technological experience were designed in-house. The graphic design was done in-house. So yeah, all
that's
all
a nice piece of the puzzle to add in.
Yes. I think you
rehearsed
that.
Thank you. Congratulations. Glad to see there's so many badass women in Panama.
Thank you.
It's like, you know, the Museum of Contemporary Art in Panama. So,
yeah.
My question was directed at you specifically.
Yeah.
Before coming over, did you in your head knew that you were going to face so much backlash? And
no.
How did, okay. And once you did, how did you kind of keep moving forward? You know, because you're the lead, right? So you have to inspire others.
That we need a glass of wine to do
it.
It was a shock. I knew my country could be sexist and ageist, but the amount of backlash that I received of people that didn't even know me, I was like, there was a news article and people commenting on that, and I was like, they were like, she's not even Panamanian. Because they said that I was traveling back from London, and I was like, yeah, because Gonzalez is from Oxford. it was really tricky. Honestly, it was mostly family support and therapy. I commend therapy. Mental health is very important, and in positions of leadership, we sometimes burn out and forget that we need to vent and talk about our issues without imploding the entire organization. So. And a great team that did stay on after all the challenges we faced, and some new members that we recruited, and created a great working environment. But it took a while, so the first few months were very difficult.
Rosie.
I just want to offer a really good text called Dying to Save Ourselves.
Oh, we love that one, yeah.
That we read as a group, that of our prophylactic incubator, read it as before we went to Panama. And it explains the whole migration and the depth, and it's Barbados and Jamaica. We also went to the cemetery. When we travel, we go to the cemetery. Because in the cemetery, no doctor don't tell no tale. Right? And when you read Joy Brown, Father something another Brown, or whatever, sometimes a different surname, born Jamaica, born Barbados. Most of those tombstones tell where the citizens were born. And it also sometimes it says, speaking English in-house, Spanish ayad. Right? So in the house, they spoke to the kids when we went to Colón. A lot of the children speak Spanish fluently, but in their house, they speak Paco. So it's a very dynamic space if you haven't gone. Dying to save ourselves.
Yeah, that's a fantastic book. It's dying to better themselves. Yeah, it's fantastic. That's one of the ones Samad gave us, actually. So,
Colin Senior is the author.
Yeah.
Okay, so we're wrapping up. One last question. Okay, this was just amazing.
We just had two amazing presentations. Really, they showed you the relationship between ethnographies and history and public memory and how we go about doing this work in museums. All right, so just some follow-up announcements. Let me go back into my volunteer chat to make sure I have all of them. All right, so a reminder for our reception this evening. Sorry, just give me a second. I gotta go back through all the notices. All right, yes. So just as a reminder, our evening plans, for those of you who are presenters, you're gonna come to our invitation only dinner.
Presenters and sponsors.
Presenters and sponsors, thank you, colleague. Right, at the Diagonal Art Foundation for 6:30. And for the rest of you, you'll be having wonderful drinks at Drink All Night at the distillery, the John Watling Distillery at 6:30 on the Lancy Street. That coconut.
That drink was everything.
That drink was amazing.
Yeah, it was.
It's a good time to talk about things that go wrong that should not be said on recording and stream. All right. So everyone, this has been a great session. Let's all give our presenters a round of applause.